Stay up to date on the latest political news this election season for less. Visit inforum.news/port and get 3 months of unlimited access to our news network for only 99 cents a month. Subscribe now at inforum.news/port. This podcast is brought to you by the North Dakota Petroleum Foundation. From heating our homes and powering our vehicles to cell phones, clothing, and medical equipment, oil and natural gas makes everyday life better. North Dakota Oil and Natural Gas, advancing the possibilities. Learn more at ndpetroleumfoundation.org. Forum Communications Company is proud to be a part of the Trust Project. Learn more at thetrustproject.org. Welcome to Plain Talk, and I am so happy to be with you, and so happy, by the way, to be introducing what will be the first in a series of I've been calling them conversations, I guess we could call them debates, between every statewide candidate who's going to be on North Dakota's ballot this cycle. I say that, now I immediately have to correct myself. Not necessarily every candidate. Two of the candidates, including one who is involved in the race we're going to be talking about today, at this point are not participating. Today we're going to be talking with Public Service Commissioner Julie Fedorchak. Of course, Chad Oban, my Wednesday co-host, is joining us. Melanie Moniz, her Democratic-NPL challenger, chose not to participate. I got in touch with her through Democratic-NPL Chairman Patrick Hart. He said that she opted to pass, so she's not participating. But coming up next week on July 7th, we will be having the U.S. House candidates, including incumbent Kelly Armstrong, independent candidate Kara Mund, and Democratic NPL candidate Mark Haugen. On September 14th, Attorney General Drew Wrigley will be on the show. I extended an invitation to Democratic candidate Tim Lamb. He's not participating, or at least he hasn't gotten back to me, I should put it that way. On September 21st, Ag Commissioner Doug Goring and Fenton Dooley, the Democratic challenger, will be on. September 28th will be the Secretary of State race between Michael Howe, Republican, and Jeffrey Powell, the Democrat. On October 3rd, the other PSC race, including Sherry Haugen Hoffert, who's currently in office, versus the Democratic challenger Trigvi Hammer. And finally, on October 26th, the U.S. Senate debate, U.S. Senator John Hoeven, the incumbent, versus Democratic candidate Katrina Christensen and independent challenger Rick Becker. So all that coming up. But today is the PSC race, and today is joining us with Julie Fedorchak. And Julie, welcome to the program. Happy to have you on.
Thank you, Rob and Chad. Happy to be here, and thank you for doing these. This is really important and great conversations to have. So,
well, I like to think so. Now, you were first appointed to the Public Service Commission in 2012.
Correct.
You have been you had to have that appointment confirmed by voters in 2014. You ran for a full 6-year term in 2016, where you were elected to a full 6-year term, and now you're running for another 6-year term. So you've been there for roughly a decade.
Correct.
Tell us, what do you think your accomplishments are? Tell people who are considering, you know, who should they vote for? What have you done for us?
Sure. I'd be happy to talk about that. So it's been an interesting experience serving on the Public Service Commission. In the almost 10 years that I've been there, we've tackled a number of different issues. You know, when I first started, the oil and gas development was going strong. There was a major boom going on, tons of pipeline construction happening. And one of the biggest issues was reclamation of those pipelines. And there was landowner fatigue because the reclamation wasn't happening. So we went to work and tried to enhance the commission's oversight on the reclamation. And we did that. We got a third party inspection going, and that's been in place and working really well for the last number of years. We started another big problem was the dangers of transporting by crude. And so
transporting crude by rail.
Crude by rail. Correct. Thank you, Rob. So recognizing those dangers and the ability for the state to have its own rail safety program that worked in tandem with the federal safety program, I spearheaded an effort to start such a rail program, got it passed by the legislature, have implemented that, and that's been running strong for going on, I think, 6 to 8 years now, and doing great work. We have two inspectors. They're cross-trained. They're covering four different disciplines, finding all kinds of defects with the rail system and working with the railroads to make sure that those defects are addressed and don't turn into bigger issues. And I think we're seeing the benefits of that and the importance of having that investment in our state because the railroad is so vital to our two biggest industries, agriculture and energy. So that's another big thing, accomplishment. Have worked to help our companies extend natural gas service to some rural communities. We worked with Gwinner, got that one going with MDU. Hillsboro is now going, becoming connected with a new small natural gas utility that's serving in the northeast corner of the state. And we've got a number of those communities up there that are being connected by natural gas. So that's another, some of these are things that have happened sort of under the radar, but they're things that we just keep plugging away on. And then of course, you know, wind development has been significant in the state. We've got almost 3,000 megawatts of wind in service, nameplate capacity. And along with that come the impacts to the people. We've worked really hard to try to mitigate those impacts. One of them being the red lights. We're the first state in the nation to require the wind farms to implement the light mitigating technology. We got that approved by the legislature and passed and is in play in North Dakota, and other states are looking to us for how to emulate what we've done there. And then, you know, always we're working really hard on the costs and reliability issues with the grid and the transition. And that's currently what's taking the bulk of my time. I've gotten very involved with the organization of MISO states. I am the immediate past president of that organization, served for a year as president last year, really to give North Dakota a voice in that arena that is more and more having a greater influence on our state's electric grid, the power that we have, the costs that are charged to our customers, and the reliability issues. And so I'll continue with that. If given in a second term, I want to continue with that. I've also worked myself into a leadership position in the National Association, and I'm scheduled to be president in 2024. And I'm looking forward to that opportunity again to elevate the importance of the issues that we see in North Dakota, being cost and reliability, keeping those at the forefront as we contemplate and work towards the energy transition, incorporating all these new exciting technologies, but not losing sight of the most important thing that the grid must do, which is to provide power to people every day at a price that they can afford.
Commissioner Fedorchak, I will be honest, I don't know a lot about the Public Service Commission, so I actually did some preparation here and found this annual report that the PSC puts out that is very, very interesting and sort of talks through the work that you all do. But one of the things that I hear most often about, or there seems to be the most publicity around, is often when the PSC is considering rate changes or rate increases for electricity customers or gas customers. Can you talk a little bit about when those kind of things come before you? And obviously you talked about how that affects consumers. At the end of the day, we all want to turn on our light and we all want it to be cheap when we do that. What sort of goes through your process in making the determination of approving a rate increase? Because I think that probably is the biggest thing that you guys do that that people see affecting them directly.
Absolutely. So it's interesting the process the PSC has, and a lot of people don't realize that we actually have staff that get separated when we get a rate case, and they're the advocacy staff, and they basically are representing the customers, whether it's industrial customers or residential customers, any of the customers, and they look at the rate case or the rate increase request from that lens. And they have money that comes to us in the form of an application fee that we use to hire outside consultants to tear apart the company's case. And so we look at all their requests for revenue increases. What's driving them? Are they prudent? Are they necessary? Where could we cut back? And they come at, they bring that forward, a case kind of against the company's rate increase request. And then we take, in a hearing process, we take the company, they make their advocacy for their case and what they believe is reasonable. We take the advocacy staff's case, listen to all that, And then we as commissioners, and we have staff helping us too, we look at all those factors and try to come up with a best case forward. What really is necessary, what's prudent, what's going to have the best impact on the reliability, maintaining that, maintaining a healthy company while also keeping the rates low. And so that's really how we manage that process. But I think what people don't necessarily understand is that we do have this sort of third party group that we create, and they have funds that are provided by the company, really, that come to us in the form of an application fee that we use to hire third party consultants that really, you know, tear up the case and try to really get to the nuts and bolts of what's needed.
Speaking about that, you know, you talked about your tenure there for 10 years, and obviously grid reliability is a big issue right now. And I think that's tied in a lot to the rate, because part of the rate case is utilities, power companies saying we have to do this, we have to make these investments in order to you know, continue to provide reliable power, but it has a cost, right? There's no such thing as a free lunch. So speak a little bit about that, because I know a lot of people are concerned, and you know, obviously we had some outages. You know, I think Texas was kind of the epicenter of the ones that made national headlines, but they touched us. You know, part of what was happening in Texas ended up touching us here in North Dakota. When I talk to people, I think they have a hard time sort of separating how their power reaches their home. Like they see the coal plant and they assume, well, my power must come from there. It's like, no, all that power is going to Minnesota. right. So I think it's hard. Like, I think it's hard for a lot of people to understand, because it is really complicated. But talk a little bit about reliability. I mean, because it also gets mixed up in the politics of where our power comes from, where you have people pushing wind and solar and some people saying, no, we got to keep coal. No, we need nuclear. It's very complicated and very confusing and very fraught, given all the politics. And here you are at the epicenter of it. So speak about that a little bit.
Yeah, it is complicated. And I think one of the things that people need to understand is all of our investor-owned utilities and the co-ops to some extent as well, they're serving multiple states. And so they plan for their system, which serves Otter Tail Power, serves in Minnesota, North Dakota, South Dakota. MDU serves in North Dakota, South Dakota, Montana. XL Energy serves in Minnesota, North Dakota, South Dakota, and Wisconsin. And so when those companies make their plans for how they're going to serve their customers, they are also serving bosses in all of those states and serving the priority needs of all of those, the policy needs of all those different states. And so it can be tricky when you've got Minnesota that is very aggressively pursuing and wants to be a leader in developing the new renewable technologies and transferring away from traditionals to renewables. They want to be a leader in that. North Dakota doesn't allow the consideration of carbon dioxide emissions in its as an externality. So they're polar opposite, and there's XL Energy having to deal with both of those policies. And so first and foremost, we are advocating for North Dakota's policies, North Dakota's priorities when we're working with those companies and trying to get them to support a generation mix that reflects those priorities. And that's the same with Otter Tail, and it's the same with MDU. Where it gets even more tricky is that all of those companies are also selling their power into these regional transmission organizations that serve far beyond those three or four states into 15 state territory in MISO. And all the policy desires of the states in that region are reflected through the market in MISO as well. So those come to play. So it does get to be really complicated. And one of the things that both Randy Christman and I have done since we have been become commissioners is recognizing that there's a lot of policy decisions made at the RTO or the regional transmission organization level. We need to be at that. We need to have a seat at that table, and preferably a seat in leadership. And so both of us have done that and helped elevate North Dakota's concerns, North Dakota's priorities. There are concerns in the grid because we have moved too quickly to retire the traditional resources around which the grid and all of its operations is based into the renewable resources around which the grid is not has not traditionally operated and is learning how to function. And so before we can complete that transition, it needs to be perfected. How do we do this with these intermittent resources? That has not happened yet. We haven't perfected that. Meanwhile, we've retired too many of the traditional resources around which the grid functions. So we need to slow down and step back and make sure that we don't exacerbate that by further retiring and further walking away from the traditional resources before we get in place the proper mix of generation to maintain the reliability. So that's a concern that we're working on right now. We do that in rate cases when we say to XL or Otter Tail or MDU, we think your mix of generation is prudent, or we don't think it's prudent and we think you should go in this direction instead. So that comes to play in the rate cases, as well as looking at what sort of investments they need in the system to maintain the reliability, like transmission needs or new generation assets, et cetera. So all of that comes to play on a very local level when it comes to rate increases, and it comes to play at a regional level when we're engaging on those MISO and SPP stakeholder community opportunities.
I'm going to shift gears just a little bit. I'm of the opinion that North Dakota has the best state employees in the country. This is maybe a little bit personal here. I'm going here, but you'd mentioned earlier when talking about like the rate increases and the staff's role in that. And, you know, I assume the PSC staff has some really technical skills that are transferable to the private sector. Mm-hmm. And I worry that our public sector employees get paid on average like 10% less than private sector folks. First of all, do you agree with all that? Secondly, do you think as a commissioner, you have a role to advocate for your employees at the legislature to get raises to make them more competitive so you can keep the best and the brightest working for the state?
Chad, I do agree with, I think, everything that you said. We have incredible employees at the Public Service Commission. They are extremely technical in order to effectively understand all the issues we just talked about and engage in them. It requires a unique skill. You have to be smart. You have to be analytical. You have to understand engineering, economics, accounting, all of these fields that are highly desirable in the private sector. So you have to understand that. And you also need to be able to work well with people, have good communication skills, be able to develop relationships, collaborate, all those other soft skills as well. So our employees are, you know, we put a premium on them. What the level of our employees and their skills equals translates directly into how much we can get done, how effectively we can regulate the utilities, and how effectively we can advocate for policies that maintain reliability and keep things affordable. So we have had an 80%, we've gone through the transition at the Public Service Commission since 2019, we have 80% new staff. So that was through the pandemic, past the pandemic, and now on the other side of it. How have we been able to recruit people? A number of things. First of all, we're not afraid to do everything we can to pay them as much as we possibly can. Like my goal in hiring is not to hire as cheaply as possible, but to hire the very best person and pay them as much as we can afford to. And I believe, and then we expect performance. Like we want these people to perform. And we put a premium on that. We're working very hard on our annual reviews, baking those in, making sure that people are getting there and there, and the high performers are rewarded and the low performers are encouraged to pull up because nothing erodes the morale of an organization quicker than people who aren't performing, because then everybody else is like, well, they're getting what I'm getting, So I'm working really hard and putting in extra hours and, you know, trying to get better. And this person over here is doing, you know, the bare minimum, yet we're being treated the same. So we are trying to do both and also creating a really fun culture. So we do a lot of extra things. We just completed a Best Burgers in Bismarck rating where we went out every Monday throughout the summer to a different burger joint for lunch and just, rated them on like 10 different qualities. And we'll announce the winning location tonight at our staff picnic. We just like have a chili cooking contest every January, right? Kind of in connection with the Super Bowl. We always have a big staff Christmas party. We have a book club. We just do a lot of other things to make it a fun place to work. So I think that we're trying to get the mix of maintaining good staff, rewarding them, creating a culture. And then when you lose people, you lose people. But if you're an attractive place to work, you'll go out and recruit somebody to replace them.
I don't know if you noticed that both Rob and I perked up when we heard that Monday burger thing. we're getting our resumes updated.
Yeah.
Best burger in Bismarck.
Well, I don't know. I don't think I'm qualified to work at the PSC.
Me either.
but I am qualified to eat hamburgers. I will. I wanted because I obviously the grid reliability issues are. You mentioned needing to have a seat at the table with some of the, and I agree with you. And again, for people to understand, when we talk, and I had a guy who worked at a power utility who emailed me and he said, don't call the regional operators the power grid. They're not the power grid. They're the regional operator. And I was like, okay, pal, listen, I'm talking to the public, right? This is how we see it. It's the power grid, right? This is how we think of it.
I agree with you.
But it's two grids, essentially, MISO and SPP. They serve North Dakota. And it's really weird, like how the map looks. There's like an island of MISO and then SPP. So which grid you're on, even if you look at the map, you'd probably be confused. So, but anyway, you talked about needing to have a seat at the table when we're talking about, you know, reliability issues. What is that relationship like now? You know, because I'm trying to think of like the levers that the PSC has. I mean, obviously you have rate where you can talk to utilities, you know, in the context of rate increases, you know, you can have influence over that when you're citing wind farms. Like there's what's your leverage point with the grid? I mean, what gives you a seat at the table? Sure. How do you get that?
Well, there's these organizations in both MISO and SPP of regulators. The state regulators have their own organization. In MISO, it's called the Organization of MISO States. So each state sends one commissioner representative to that organization, the Organization of MISO States, and that group collectively talks through, works through, discusses, and tries to come to some uniform agreement on policies that MISO is considering. And so working your way into a leadership role in that group helps you collectively work with others in other states who are viewing MISO policies and plans and to try to get, you know, sort of on the same page so that you can collectively say to MISO, the state regulators think this or that or the other thing. It also, you know, you can't always agree because different states have different policy priorities, but there is more agreement than you would think because the one thing I appreciate about regulators, it's not a partisan job. I mean, people have partisan beliefs, but the job itself is not partisan. And I work with and have come to have great relationships and friendships with state regulators in that are extremely liberal, extremely conservative. It doesn't matter. We work together. And so we work together and the same happens in SPP. And so for example, MISO right now has some problems in its markets. They need to be adjusted to better reward resources that provide the attributes in terms of reliability, dispatchability, voltage support, frequency, all of these things. Those resources need to be better rewarded in the market. So there needs to be market changes. I'm working with my colleagues in the Organization of MISO States, all the state commissioners, to recommend what we think MISO needs to be doing to better reward those attributes in the market. I mean, that's a very nerdy, specific, technical thing, but it has a huge difference because every utility is planning their resource mix partially because of how they reward in the market. You know, you hear like, oh, that coal plant, Coal Creek Station, was being retired because it wasn't economic. That was being blamed on the market, and the market wasn't paying Coal Creek Station for all the things that it was providing to the grid.
I've always thought of it as they're not, we kind of think of all the electrons that get put on the grid as the same, but to me, they're different sorts. Like if it's coming from an intermittent source, that is a different product than is something that is coming from a baseload source. Because a coal plant can operate, doesn't matter. The wind doesn't need to blow, the sun doesn't need to shine. A coal plant or a natural gas plant or a nuclear plant can produce that electron no matter what. That is a different product than the wind turbine, where the wind has to blow in order for that electron to be produced. Is it right to think of it that way? These are different products, and there needs to be a price mechanism to reflect that. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly. It is a different product. I think the confusion started because when renewables were first interconnected to the grid, I don't think even the grid operators fully appreciated the difference in what kind of attributes they had and how they impacted the grid differently. And so there was this like, you know, all of the above, fuel neutrality, you know, all this sort of thing. And now, having done this now for 10, 15 years, the grid more appreciates like what different attributes each of these resources brings and how you need a mix of them and how they need to be valued differently. And so,
I can get to work on a motorcycle or in a car, but I'll tell you, one works better than the other in January. So,
exactly.
What is that? I'm sorry. Chad's got a question.
If you want to keep diving deeper into this, go ahead. I was going to go a different direction.
Okay. Well, just one quick follow-up. What does that look like? If we get away from what you were talking about, sort of the neutrality, all of the above thing, what does it look like? In a way, to be fair, to like wind and solar, who I think have a role to play, but, you know, how do we get to something that's workable? What does that look like to you?
So that's one of the most exciting things and interesting things working in MISO right now. So they're changing a bunch of different constructs and how they have their market designed and how they plan. So they used to plan for one peak a year in the summer, and everybody had to plan. Every utility had to meet its obligation to help MISO meet that peak, right? And they were assigned a certain amount of megawatts that they had to have plus a reserve margin, and everyone built to that. Well, we recognize like it doesn't work that way anymore with intermittent resources. There's different times of the year where things are offline. There's more premium. There's a shortage of gas in the winter, and so we might not be able to get it for our gas generators because it's being used for home heating. So now they've got a seasonal construct. So each of the utilities needs to plan for a peak in each season. That's a very different planning construct that requires different resources. And so naturally the utilities will have to adjust what they have available in each season, making sure they have enough of the thermal dispatchable stuff. And then they can blend it in with the renewables as they're able to do that and still maintain reliability. So there's a bunch of different tools like that. The seasonal construct, they're accrediting their resources differently. So they're looking at how did this, they've always accredited resources, meaning like this coal fleet has 100 megawatt capacity. We accredit it for 95 megawatts because we think it's available 95% of the time, basically. Wind typically has been accredited 15 to 17% of its nameplate capacity in MISO because that's what they believe they can count on wind providing to meet that peak demand. So they're changing how they're accrediting resources too. Rather than looking at a coal fleet and giving it a flat like 95% or whatever, they're looking at coal, gas, nuclear. How were you available at these peak times in the last 3 years, like when it was the tightest times of the year in the market in the last 3 years, how did you perform? That's what you're going to be rated on. And so it's much more real life and it's much more appropriate because they need to know in real conditions how these units are performing, not just in perfect conditions, right? And so they're giving those a credit, and that's what those companies can use then to help meet its overall obligation, which MISO sets. And so Those are two good examples. There's others that are being evolved and considered, and there will actually be market mechanisms to pay resources for the attributes that they have, whether it be spinning reserve, ramping time, fuel availability. There will be different ways that the market contemplates paying and rewarding those generators for those attributes in the future, which will then change the behavior of the utilities who are considering using them. And that's how you will hopefully readjust the market and get the utilities to invest in the most optimal resources to protect reliability while also keeping the cost down.
So it seems like often the Public Service Commission is in the crosshairs of sort of the ethics community, because PSC is a regulatory agency. And I went back and looked at some of your campaign contributions. It looks like you're fortunate that you haven't had to raise much money since 2016. So how do you respond to, you know, people who say, you know, you're taking contributions from a company you may regulate or an industry you may regulate? And I struggle with that a bit, because it's like, how's that different than giving money to a legislator who's going to create policy? And I suppose it's a little bit different, but how do you stay sort of above the politics, make sure those contributions don't influence decisions? And again, I just want to reiterate, looking at your contribution reports, there's nothing controversial for several years.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Chad. A couple things. First of all, I have never and never will take a donation from a company that I regulate, because corporate donations are not allowed in North Dakota. So I don't take corporate donations. I never have and never will. I take PAC donations, and I will take PAC donations from any of the organization, you know, basically any organization. I've taken them from labor. I've taken them from environmental groups. I've taken them from the Lignite Energy Council, NextEra PAC. I mean, those organizations are supported by employees who want to contribute their money to support the political process. I think that's important that those employees can do that and can work together to support and to be involved in the political process in ways that they think advances what they support. So I think PAC donations are perfectly defendable. They're perfectly ethical. They're 100% reportable, and everything, every donation that I've taken, I also report on the Secretary of State's website for anybody to see. And I encourage people, look at my donations. And if you think that I'm being influenced by them and my decisions reflect that, then you should support somebody else.
Yeah. And, you know, we've talked a lot, Rob and I, about just transparency. I mean, we want transparency. I don't think we need to overregulate this stuff. And it is interesting. You talked about getting contributions from labor, from wind, from fossil fuels, whatever. I was looking through your 2016 report, because it is out in the open. And I'm guessing that you had PAC contributions from both sides of several issues over the years. So it's interesting that, you know, looking at that campaign contribution report, you've got contributions from all over the place, and it seems like that must mean you're a fair judge in these cases, and that's why everybody would support you in that way. So
the one thing I will say on this whole ethics issue is I am conscious of it, because there's so little faith in public servants nowadays that I don't want to be flippant about the whole ethics issue or the transparency issue or accountability. It is important, and I don't want to be taking donations from anybody who would make the public have less faith in my decision-making process. So I think just keeping that in mind all the time also is part of our job, is just being conscious of what you're doing, why, being transparent about it, and being able to explain it to, you know, the citizens who are looking at electing you to do the job.
Well, Julie, I thank you so much for your time.
Wait, Rob, don't wrap it up yet. I've got one final question.
Okay.
As I said, I looked at the biannual report, and there were 46 cases that came before the PSC on auctioneers. Yes. And I have to know what that means. What, like, are people like reporting bad auctioneers, or what is
that? I think that might have. So we license and bond all the auctioneers, and so the cases that came before us may have been just like calls. I don't know that we had formal cases against. Okay. I've never had any formal case of. Against an auctioneer in my time at that.
So there were 46 auctioneers and only 12 railroads. And I was like, what is happening with the auctioneers in this state?
Yeah. I'm guessing that's... there's a lot more auctioneers than there are railroads that are
probably
railroad entities, I guess I would say. The other thing too, is when you used to fill up at the fuel pump, you'd always see the public service commissioner names on there, because another thing that they do is they regulate the pumps, right? So when you go to a scale and you get your wheat, weighed, or you yeah. go to a gas station and to make sure that those numbers, because sometimes I look at those numbers like, I don't know, like I gotta do some math.
Yeah,
I don't know if I'm getting the commercial right number scales, of gallons.
Yeah, here. that's one of, so when you mentioned earlier, the area where we work the most or have the most impact is probably the rate regulation. I actually think it's in the commercial scales and measuring devices. That's probably where we have the biggest impact, because every single scale, whether it's at your yogurt shop, your deli, your meat, you know, the gas station, those are all commercial, commercially regulated, and they have to file with us a tolerance for, you know, that they've been checked, they're licensed every year. And so we oversee a lot of the overseers of that. So that's another little.
So you regulate my butcher, my 3B meat. Scale?
One of the oldest responsibilities of the commission. And if you think about commerce, people have to have faith in these commercial scales and measuring devices.
Right.
Or the economy would kind of fall apart. Well, so you have to know that what you're getting paid for is actually fair.
Think about how hugely important that is in North Dakota, right? Like, again, you're a farmer, right? And you're selling so many pounds of, I don't know, soybeans or something. You pull up on that scale and you just think of how much money you could make if your scale was just like 5% off. Right. Yep. How much more money you could make just cheating people. And I mean, you just assume like the scale says that there's actually a government agency that makes sure that scale at the deli counter is delivering you the appropriate quantity of roast beef. And I tell you, I got to appreciate
love
that.
It.
I love it. Yeah. Julie, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Hi there. My name is James Wallner. I produce and host the podcast Dakota Spotlight, a true crime podcast that tackles historical and unsolved crimes in the upper Midwest. Follow along with me as we search for a missing girl, attempt to solve a 45-year-old murder, and much, much more. That's Dakota Spotlight Podcast, anywhere you get your podcasts, or at inforum.com/podcasts.
Well, that was a great interview with Julie Fedorchak. And you know, one of the things, the value I think in talking about, like people are like, oh, the PSC race, who cares about that one? There are things that the government does, like the weights and measures thing, that you just don't even realize. Like how just hugely, I remember I was reading this biography about Herbert Hoover. And it wasn't during his presidency, but he actually served as the Federal Trade Commissioner. And one of the things he did was standardizing like weights and measures, right? And how hugely important that was to the American economy. Like he came up with like, you know, this is how big a foot is, because that would vary from place to place. This is how much a pound weighs. This is how big a brick should be, so that you could go to different places in the world and buy different things. And there were standard sizes, which made construction and everything else so much easier. Like stuff like that, I think people don't. We get so caught up in you know, hot button issues and should it be this or should it be that, and we forget about just that sort of baseline level of just, you know, the scale's going to read a pound and it's going to be accurate and you're not going to get cheated at your grocery store. How important that really is. Like you can kind of laugh about it, but it is really important.
Yeah, Rob, as somebody who just a week ago said, what the heck are we going to talk to Julie Fedorchak about and joked about weights and measures. And then again, I mean, I'm not joking. I look through their report and it's amazing how many things the PSC is involved in that affects all of our lives. You know, I just think about it as sort of an energy regulatory agency, but it's so much more. And weights and measures, I mean, you just think about like a gas pump. You know, you talked about if it's like
2% off.
Yeah. I mean,
how much they could be ripping off if
right.
It's
yeah.
It's,
and would you and I know if it was off by 2%?
How
I mean,
I know
how big my gas tank is, but if it's off by 2%, I don't think that I'm going to know that.
Right. Like, I mean, if it's off by like a lot, okay, I would probably notice, but like, what am I going to drain my gas tank and check? Like, of course not. Of course not. I'm going to pay my bill and move on with my day. So really interesting stuff. Let's move on. Other hot button topics in the issue. The student loan thing. I have a print column out about it today. And I don't like the, well, you could say this about just about any political topic in America right now. I don't like the unnuanced way that we're talking about this. And let me be clear up front. As I noted in my column, we have student loan debt in my household. My wife just began her career as a teacher. She's going to have to begin now that she's done with her degree. She's going to have to commence paying off some of those student loans. And by my reading of everything, we would qualify for this forgiveness. And I think we would probably qualify for up to like $20,000 of it. So in that context, right, this is me speaking against interest. I don't think President Biden has the authority to do this. I think it's an abuse of executive power. I would rather see it come through Congress. And if we are going to do student loan forgiveness, I would like to see it coupled with policy reforms to address why student loans got out of hand in the first place. Why the cost of higher education got out of hand in the first place. That's what I would like to see. That's why I'm opposing this. And it does really bother me to see some of the people, and I understand some of the people who are opposing this are perhaps being hypocritical, but you know, this whole idea that like if you've ever taken anything from the government, like you got a tax break or you got a PPP loan or you took a farm subsidy or something, now you can't oppose this program, I think is childish baby politics. And we all ought to grow up.
So first of all, your wife should look into the Public Service Loan Forgiveness Program because that's actually been around for a long time.
We're aware of it.
And,
yep.
Yes. And so so this idea of loan forgiveness is not a new one at a federal level or at a state level. I'm going to read a quote from Governor Burgum that says, I just want to make sure that I get this right. This horribly and misguided, unfair plan undermines the core American principle that individuals are responsible for paying off their own personal debts. So when you hear those kind of comments that, I mean, this is basically Americans pay off their own debts, and people are trumpeting that sort of language. I'm sorry, if you received a PPP loan, you can't also believe that Americans' core values are to pay off your own debts, or you wouldn't have taken a PPP loan. You and I both supported the PPP loan program. I think it was super beneficial, particularly in the hospitality industry where restaurants and bars were shut down and other places as well. Nobody's criticizing, as far as I know, the PPP program. It's the hypocrisy around it.
I don't think it's hypocritical. I don't think it's necessarily hypocritical. Like because that's I think that's a bait and switch.
If you agree, it's an American core principle that you pay off your own debts.
Right, but when the government, it's a different situation when the government comes and shuts your business down. Or to kicks people out of their job so that if you're a developer, people can't pay rent and people stop building and people stop doing all the other things. It was a terrible – that was an emergent situation. So you're comparing an emergency loan program in the middle of a global pandemic to people choosing to run up $50,000 of student loan debt. These are not comparable situations.
Well, it is comparable. If you believe that you pay off your own debts and you deal with, you know, pull yourself up by the bootstraps, that kind of thing. But the other thing I would say is North Dakota has a lot of student loan forgiveness programs, many of which I support, for veterinarians, for teachers, for all kinds of different things.
The authority that President Biden is claiming, and I think falsely, I think it's inappropriate, but it was actually a student loan forgiveness program for Iraq and Afghanistan veterans that was created. So, it's called the HEROES Act.
Again, under that theory, though, that everybody pays back their debts, it's American principle, should we have any of those programs? Sure. And is it not hypocritical because a Democratic president has this program that it's evil and socialist and whatever, but yet over on this
those
other
are not,
side...
Those were not Governor Burgum's words.
No, not at all. I mean, but he said, I quoted him
But he said, you know, if you want to say that Governor Burgum is guilty of engaging in some hyperbole, then you're right. But I don't, I think you could say the PPP program in context was good policy and this in context is not. People are allowed to use their logic and their reason to reach those conclusions.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, people can have those, you know, policy disagreements.
And it doesn't make them hypocrites.
How does it not? I supported
the PPP. Not to be clear, I didn't take any PPP loans.
Yeah.
But I supported the PPP program. By the way, I also receive like when I file my taxes, I get like tax credits and stuff for my children. Does that mean I have to support every other program that the government proposes?
Yeah, I think that we need to just be careful about talking about this particular program as being against our American core values, principles, while there's all kinds of other programs that give tax cuts to wealthy businesses or the PPP loans, or there's all kinds of programs. There's programs that just benefit farmers.
Sure.
That this is the way the government works. I mean, the fact is, we like to say the government shouldn't pick winners and losers, but that's essentially what the government does in both parties.
Sure. Well, first of all, let me draw a distinction between tax cuts, which are allowing you to keep more of your own money, and something like this, which is giving you other people's money. Those are different things. But another part of my problem. I calling somebody un-American because they support loan forgiveness, I think is stupid. Don't do that. There are plenty of other reasons to be critical of this program. Another reason why is we are doing absolutely, and listen, there's some cynicism here. We're in a heated midterm, and here the president's giving away a bunch of money. That's tough to swallow. But our federal government doesn't function. There's a lot of blame for that to go around. It's the situation we're in. What really bugs me is that higher ed, I mean, if you look at the graph of inflation for different sectors of household spending, higher education it's higher than medical care has risen. It's higher than energy prices. I mean, there are very few things that have grown faster than the cost of higher education. And what's been driving that, I believe, is a lot of terrible public policy where we have turned student loans into essential entitlement, right? Where you can get a student loan and it doesn't matter what you're really doing with it, right? And so we've created a situation where people ran up a lot of debt, pursuing degrees, and put themselves in positions where they couldn't pay a lot of that debt back. I would like to see if we're going to forgive some student loans. And I think maybe we should, right? Because the government created that problem. And we put students in a position where they felt like they had to get these college degrees, and they went into a bunch of debt to get them, and now they're finding they kind of got a raw deal. Maybe we should forgive some loans, but I'm not willing to sign off on it until we reform the other part. We got to address the other side of that equation. That's what really frustrates about. Absent that reform, this is an election year giveaway, and that bothers me.
And I think absent that reform, I think there is, I agree with everything you just said. Write that down. I agree with everything Rob said about the cost of college. I mean, you look at the charts about the cost of tuition, and then you've got 18-year-old kids who are sort of signing away their future, and maybe after 3 years they figure out, man, I can make more money, or I get more satisfaction from being a plumber, and all of a sudden I've got $80,000 worth of debt that's accumulating interest from the day I start school,
right?
Not when I'm done with school, the day I start school.
So here's the thing. It's a cultural thing too, because I know my generation, our generation, you felt like if you didn't go to college right out of high school, you were a bum.
Right.
And I think that was wrong. I told my college age kid, I told her, don't go unless you have an idea. And not to say that you can't change your mind, but I mean, we were asking 18, 19, 20-year-olds to invest go in tens of thousands of dollars, if not hundreds of thousands, depending on the situation, go into a significant amount of debt very, very early in their lives, pursuing something that they're supposed to be doing for the rest of their lives. They're 18, 19, 20 years old. Wait for a while, right? I don't think that's such a bad thing. Wait for a while. Get some experience, you know, and then pursue, you know, a degree path that's going to get you what you need to pursue that thing that you want to do.
Right. It's predatory, right? I mean, it
really is.
Who aren't prepared to make these big decisions. Some of them 17, I would assume. Their parents probably have to sign as well. And don't sort of understand the long-term economics of what this looks like. I mean, you take a $100,000 loan to go to college to get a degree teaching third grade, takes a long time to pay off that debt, probably never, right? And you're probably not thinking about that as a 19-year-old. You're thinking about, I want to be a teacher. And, you know, once I get a real job, it'll pay things off. So I think doing something about the cost, and it also is a frustration about this whole conversation. You know, people who are saying, I paid for my own college. Here's the deal, Rob, I got a 4-year degree. I got some breaks because my mom helped me after my dad passed away. I didn't have student loan, but there are other people in my family that do. But you can't compare to getting a college degree 35 years ago to getting a college degree now. It costs so much different.
Even 20 years ago, when you look at the rates of inflation, even 10 years ago, 20 years ago, it's a different ballgame.
Yeah, it's a completely different ballgame. So, you know, people who are trying to get out of that debt to buy homes, to do other things, it's a huge burden. This isn't just,
here's a terrifying statistic. And this is several years out of date now, but It was the number of people who were having, right? Because that's the other thing about student loan debt. You can't just you can't like just declare bankruptcy and have it go away. It follows you forever. So I was looking, and it was actually the number of people who were having their Social Security payments garnished to pay for student loans, right? And like 30 years ago, it was zero, right? Because nobody was still paying. It was effectively zero because nobody was paying off student loans by the time they were collecting Social Security. And it went up, like it's. I mean, and granted, it's not a huge percentage, but it's been growing. And if you think about that, those are people who accrued student loan debt presumably early in life, and carried it all the way through to their retirement years, to the point where their Social Security benefits are being. That's the scope of this problem. And the other part of it is too. I mean, you look at you called it predatory. I agree. Look where the money went. I mean, look at some of our campuses across the nation that have grown, frankly, decadent. You have college administrators who have lived like pharaohs in some ways. I mean, you have these elaborate sports programs that are in no small part subsidized by tuition and tax dollars coming from the general fund of these universities, including right here in North Dakota. So, I mean, the problem is that becomes politically trickier than just giving away a bunch of money to the students. There's a whole culture there that is crying out for reform. And I think conservatives have a lot to offer that conversation. And if some buyouts of student loans is what greases the skids to maybe getting some liberals on board to reform that stuff, then I would cut that deal. Yeah, I would cut that deal.
Rob, I think now's the time to be having that conversation, though, because I think people are so much more aware of the increasing costs to get a degree. I think people are understanding more what student loan and student debt is doing to people. I mean, again, this isn't a bunch of lazy people who don't want to work. I mean, it's really people who can't get out from underneath it.
And that's a fair critic. Conservatives shoot themselves in the foot when they start everybody who's is a freeloader, or everybody is you know, somebody who wants to avoid their responsibilities, that's not the case. Like, and I mean, you can even argue the government created this problem, right? How often are we talking about the government creating problems? They created this one.
The other thing that I think, you know, the fact that people who have their loans through Bank of North Dakota don't qualify for this program. So I mean, I think if you're a North Dakotan right now, so we're essentially paying as taxpayers to benefit a bunch of people who many, you know, many North Dakotans won't qualify for this program. I wish the federal delegation would try to figure out some way to get North Dakota kids who, or North Dakota adults, I mean, even Social Security, to your point, to qualify if they you know, refinance at the Bank of North Dakota. Because, I mean, North Dakota student loan holders are the big losers in this whole thing, because if you had your loan through a private place,
it's a byproduct of our unique bank is what right. It is, because we have the Bank of North Dakota, we could have a very unique student loan program through that bank that of course the federal government is not going to think, oh, by the way, we've got to have another little carve out for North Dakota. So I don't know. Maybe there's a carve out in there somewhere. Again,
Byron and Earl always figured out those carve outs for the Bank of North Dakota.
Well, if this had gone through Congress, right? You talk about there. Nobody asked John Hoeven or Kevin Cramer or Kelly Armstrong to weigh in on this. This is Joe Biden acting unilaterally. So if you want to say Kent Conrad, yeah, that was back when we used to do things through Congress, which we're not anymore. So let's talk. Let's see. What else is going on? Kara Mund, who, by the way, is going to be participating in our debate, our House debate next week. I thought this was interesting because, again, one of the things I've said, like, you can do the independent thing and you're kind of a blank slate to a lot of people. But the minute you start campaigning, you start defining yourself. Right. That's what a campaign is all about. Defines who you are. Kara Mund having a fundraiser with some pretty high profile Democrats. And I think there's a lot of Republicans who are looking at it. She's a fundraiser at Tom Dixon's home. Tom Dixon is a spent decades involved in Democratic politics in North Dakota, was a chairman of Heidi Heitkamp's U.S. Senate campaign, former chairman of the Democratic-NPL. I think there's a lot of Republicans. I reported that invitation. I think there's a lot of Republicans looking at that and saying, independent, huh?
Yeah, I mean, one of the hosts is also the 2004 Republican Ag Commissioner candidate.
Dina Butcher has been campaigning with Democrats for a long time now. I don't know that she always gets tossed out there as like the token Republican when liberals are, this is bipartisan because Dina Butcher's a part of it. No.
So who are the other prominent Democrats then?
Tom Dixon.
You said Tom Dixon and a bunch Democrats. Tell me who they are.
Okay, well,
because there's no Democrat endorsed statewide candidate on the list. The only statewide endorsed candidates are Republican, Rob.
Okay, you look at the rest of that list, you look at them on social media, and you look at what side of the political aisle they fall down on.
I think you used the word prominent. I didn't.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry. Okay. All right, if you're holding a fundraiser at the home of the former Democratic NPL chairman, the chairman of Heidi Heitkamp's U.S. Senate campaign, the treasurer of the One America Fund that works to elect Democratic people, I think you have to wonder, why is this partisan Democrat, and I'm not using that term pejoratively, but that's who he is, why is he interested in electing Kara Mund?
Well, I'm very interested in why the 2004 Republican GOP endorsed
You're being facetious, and you know it.
Dina Butcher is, in fact, the 2004
she is.
Ag Commissioner, GOP endorsed, worked as a deputy in a Republican administration.
That was almost 20 years ago, and she's a very different person today than she was back then.
I think if you ask her, she's still a Republican.
I think that fits her political agenda very well, so she could be the token agenda on all these left wing initiatives that she's always a part of.
Yeah, she's just one of the few Republicans in the state who's willing to stand up to the Trumpy Republican Party here, and because she won't
that's
get
a very,
along
that's
with
a
the
very,
Trumpy
that's
Republican
a very
Party,
nice, that's a
they
very
kick
nice,
her out. She doesn't even count.
Nice
she doesn't even count, right?
Dina Butcher left the Republican Party before Donald Trump came on the horizon. But so let's say Kara Mund was out with a bunch of Republicans, with a bunch of oil industry guys, right? And one token Democrat wandered into the room. You wouldn't be sitting here saying, I wonder where her loyalties lay. I wonder where her ideology lays. There's nothing here to give people pause and wonder how, quote unquote, independent she is.
Here's what I will tell you is on the very day that you broke that story about the Dixon event, there's also in liberal social media land, liberals attacking her because she evidently said, and it was proven to be not true, that she would support Donald Trump for president again if he was the Republican nominee.
Okay.
And so at the very same day, I mean, it just goes to show the impossibility of running as an independent, right? Because you're gonna make the Republicans.
Okay, but one of these things was true, and the other thing was false.
Well, I don't know exactly what she said about Trump. I look forward to having her on the debate stage next week with us. But clearly, something was said about Trump that made people upset on the left, and so it was just like, how difficult it is to try to thread that, right? Because people are looking for a reason not to like you.
You can't be all things to all people. I mean, I think that's the problem. Like, everybody likes the idea of an independent candidate, and everybody likes to think of themselves as being independent, but we're all extremists for our own point of view, right? I mean, so there comes a point at which she's going to have to define herself, and inevitably that's going to make some people not like her. I think there's a lot of enthusiasm for her because she's a blank slate.
I think your point about people like an independent candidate until they disagree on a couple things, right? When Doug Burgum was elected in 2016,
same thing.
Oh, the Democrats loved him.
The blank slate.
And now not so much.
Right. So, you know, but again, and I say that that's even not even really a criticism of Doug Burgum. Although
his
campaign left much to be desired, but there's a difference between, like, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that, and I'm talking in generalities on the campaign trail, versus I'm now on the Industrial Commission and casting votes. Those are just different. When you govern, it's just the way it is.
But you can't govern unless you win an election. And I think the one thing that you can say about Doug Burgum is he really effectively won that primary and then won the general election.
And his re-election. Yeah. He won decisively. Yeah. So, that'll be interesting. I mean, Carrie Munn has to explain herself, right? I mean, that's on her as a candidate. I wish she had gotten involved in the process earlier, but I don't know. Like as a right of center person who is interested in her campaign, I've yet to see her take a position or to do anything that makes me think that she has any appeal to me at all as a right of center voter. I haven't seen it yet. Maybe it's there. I haven't seen it.
Yeah, and I just look forward to learning more.
Absolutely.
And you may be right that there isn't going to be the policies that are appealing to a left of center guy like me. But we'll see.
We'll see. Chad, as always, thanks.
Thanks, Rob.
Did you know Forum Communications Company has a robust podcast library? At inforum.com/podcast, we have everything from politics, sports, true crime, outdoor adventure, and more. Visit inforum.com/podcast and explore them all today.